ISIS data. I think we talk about HRSC and high-rise. Again, if you have any questions, you know, use the post-it notes, fill it out for later so you don't forget. And then again, we'll collect those and we'll write up summaries of all the discussions. I like to actually send out emails about what we went over and the questions were asked. So just to give you a sense of, these are kind of other questions that people have asked for in the workshops we give. So obviously the first one is, how do you load all this data? How do you load LoLa, Chrism, HiRISE, CTX, WAC? What's the best practices for lining up these instruments? What are some of the ISIS-specific idiosyncrasies? What are the quirks in ISIS? What I mean by that is that so ArcMap has built-in support for some PDS, some ISIS data, and probably in about a year, maybe Vicar directly. That means that it actually tries to read in the projection, the node data, the number of bands. It can be 32-bit, 16-bit, doesn't matter. The problem is that ISIS supports, as a format, supports 5 node data values. ArcMap supports 1. So if ISIS comes in with 5 node data values, you have to understand how to map that. So other questions, how to do 3D, projections, 0 to 360 longitudes is problematic for ArcMap and QGIS. So when you think of longitude systems, it's best to create your data in minus 180 to 180. Positive west does not exist in ArcMap. You can use positive west data, but it really is using positive east longitudes. No map projection that I know of supports positive west. Behind ISIS says it supports positive west, but behind its back, it's really supporting east. So it's just a flag. It's a toggle flag. And I'll show a toolbar that we have that can display west, but again, think in terms of east. West is not good. So making shapefiles, polygons, point locations, how do you make feature catalogs? How do you digitize channels? Those are some questions. Automatic attribution, that means I need to set this crater as a pedestal, or I need to set this crater as a young or old. And what do I mean by automated? That just means that those are predefined attributes so that it's just a pull down. Crater counting tools, we're not gonna go over that today, but the Freie University, Thomas Neisel, has some awesome tools for helping with crater counting. And then, of course, crater stats was presented yesterday also. And we won't go over Python scripting, but I'll be happy to run classes in that too. So 20 years, GIS, this is what I get paid to do. I do get paid to support GIS in the community, so feel free to ask questions afterwards, email. If I have an answer, I'll send it. There are a lot of online supports. Google's your friend, of course. But there actually are some really good training videos that ESRI supports. They're free. There's workshops. They do these WebExes online. They're actually pretty good. And there's lots of books. So what I like to think about ArcMap and QGIS and all these is that GIS is a visual language. The reason why I like it is because it's interactive. You're not sitting there writing, you know, command line codes and then you pop up a figure. You don't just make figures, you're actually interacting with the data and you're playing with it and you're massaging it. And that's why I've always liked it. So again, here's our brief intro. I think the most important thing that people don't understand about GIS is that it has, you visualize data, but that data has information underneath it. So the polygon knows what size it is. The polygon knows what unit it is or what age it is. And so there's tabular data or there's information behind each feature. And that's true for pixels too. If you think of pixels, pixels have a value. There's a way to represent rasters as values have pixels. And so if you think about that, that's more of a classified, on Earth it's mostly vegetation data. These pixels this or this group of pixels called trees, this classification called trees owns these pixels. So I can select trees and it selects the pixels for me. So pixels are a database. You can think of it both ways. Pixels have values, values own pixels. And you can act like that too. So, and you don't have to convert it to polygons. And the reason why we went to geologic mapping, we really heavily pushed for that for our GIS for geologic mapping is that they can be updated. Something changes, there's a new base, the registration's bad, we'll release a version 2. So the paper maps are nice, but they're very hard to update. You can see the evolution of GIS. I think this was made clear last year, just even looking over the publication amount. But you know, in the 70s, there was kind of mostly GIS developers, and now we're down into 2000s, and there's millions of GIS users. And you could say that some of this is spurred on by, you know, engines like Google Earth, just because it made GIS so simple. Whether you're working with global or local, doesn't matter. You can work on eyeballs. You can work on astronomy. I haven't done it. But it's good at different scales. So a lot of times for planetary, we're working on global scales, which means that you have to be cognizant of the map projection, the distortion. You have to do the right thing when you calculate area. ArcMap doesn't always think for you. So you have to kind of understand what it's doing in the background. But there's tools out there to facilitate that. So if you want to get fault densities and you're dividing it by an area, you need to make sure that that area is not influenced by the map projection. And so I'll talk to that for 2 seconds. But just be cognizant of that. ArcMap doesn't do everything scientifically valid. Sometimes you have to think for it. You have to understand what it's doing. And there's ways to check that to make sure you're doing okay. And that's as far as, you know, taking a length, seeing if the calculated length in your features are the same. So one of the things that's very robust about GIS, and this is a very simplistic that we did with JPL landing site analysis. So GIS is meant for overlay analysis, whether it's polygons, but we have here we're showing visual. You notice my visual base is not used in the calculation. But I have tests for dust, roughness from slope, topography for I need to land under a certain elevation. These go into, and this is all called a model. And you basically, you load these data sets and you hit play and you end up with what I call a targetability map. And so these are fairly easy to set up. There's even, ARC has even a drag and drop interface to set this kind of workflow up. And the bottom line is that it's just facilitating, you know, you want to run this over and over again. Tweak the parameters, tweak the elevation. I set a different elevation, I rerun it, and it only processes what it needs to process. So one of the examples I give, I worked for a couple weeks for SpaceX. SpaceX needs to land their Dragon. They don't want to land it in the ocean eventually. So in the next 10 years, they're going to land it somewhere in the US. So we needed to find a place in the US that was safe to land with a giant buffer away from populated areas, away from roads, away from utility lines. And so basically we used this type of model to say, we need to be 20 kilometers away from utility lines, we need to be 50 kilometers away from populated areas. And over the US, it's very hard to find a landing spot for Dragon. It's easier in the west, it's hard in the east. And so we're looking at water, we're looking at flat, but that's what a GIS can facilitate. Looking at multiple layers to gather an answer. So this is ArcMap, we'll look at this. You can notice on the left side, there's about 50 layers. You can have basically as many layers as you want. The more layers you add, the slower it gets. So there's tricks to make 100 layers look like one. And that's something that, as a power user, if you load 100 high-rise images, you can. If you load them in the interface, it's gonna be slow. If you pretend they're one layer, it becomes fast. And we'll talk about, there's several different ways to do that. We'll talk about an HRSC version at the end. But again, don't be afraid to load data. if it doesn't work, then we'll look, then you have to understand, okay, what do we look at for projections? What do we look at? Why is it not working? So as any GIS, the cost of it is gathering data, data conversion, and data update. The 20% is the analysis, is the fun part. So just understand that when you go into a GIS, there is going to be a lot of time spent on gathering data, getting the data to work. And that's one thing we've been trying to work at with PDS and ISIS, is how do we make that step easier so we're not spending hours converting data to different formats. I think you guys are all familiar with this. Two main geographic data models, vector, raster. So vectors are points, lines, polygons, rasters, images. Let's jump through here. Again, here's this discrete Douglas fir. Douglas fir owns these pixels, and I can select Douglas fir, and those pixels highlight, and then I can do something with those selected pixels. It's kind of a twist on how you think of rasters, but it's really handy. So if we go through ArcMap, for those who have never seen it, it's typical. You'll have, if you're used to Illustrator or a graphical, you'll have a layer list on the left. That's called the table of contents. A lot of times that disappears, so you have to go find it in the menu. You'll have toolbars over here. There's a new thing called catalog, and that's actually your kind of your file explorer, your finder. It's how you find data. If everybody can start up ArcMap, you can get a sense of how this looks. You notice toolbars down here you might not have. There's about, I don't know, 50 toolbars. And so if you turn them all on, you're not going to be able to see any data. So you turn them on as you need them, turn them off. So ArcMap has two modes. It has a data mode. This is the data view. This is called the top thing over here on the left is called the data frame. Where the map is the data frame. And then in another mode, it has a layout mode. And think of this as, this is how you make your posters and your figures. You'll notice that here we have page sizes on the left and the top. So we're looking at not the data, but the data in context of a figure, the data in context of a page size. And this could, again, this could be A4, it could be, 2 by 2 inches, it could be a poster 60 by 60. And you'll also notice the most important part here is this. This is the scale at which this page size is allowing this map. And so, again, that's important. If you're gonna be making a final map for LPSC or other, you'll wanna have note on that. Layout allows you to add north arrows, scale bars. It's all dynamic. As you zoom in, the scale bar changes size. As you zoom out, if you rotate the frame, the north arrow changes. So everything's dynamic. If you add a grid with lat lons, as you zoom in, the lat lons change. So it's very dynamic. And you can have multiple data frames in a single layout. Catalog view, again, is just the how do you get around in the data. So this is just my, for those who are used to ArcMap, this is my top 10 list of what's good in 10 and above. So we've had ISIS and PDS support since 9.3, I think. We've had planetary support since 9.0. So we've had planetary support in ArcMap for about 10 years, I think. 10 actually fixed a lot of problems with PDS and ISIS support. So it's pretty good. You're not going to find it supports everything. Some of the neat add-ons, real-time image analyst. So you can do hill shades without creating hill shades. They're just virtual. You can do virtual processing. I can take image 1 minus image 2 virtually without actually creating anything on disk. When I do create it on disk, it takes a while to run. But this image is kind of extremely powerful and not many people use it yet. Attribution is easier. There's a new mosaic type that I'll try to demo at the end. Basically, I can use any resolution, any map projected data. They could all be different. So HRSC, all the DEMs are in different map projections. If I create a mosaic, it's called a mosaic data type, and I throw all these images in, it doesn't matter if they're different resolutions, different aerial coverages, different map projections, they all merge into one mosaic. And it's all virtual. There's no extra files until you optimize it. And you can, and you go, well, that would be too slow. It is slow until you do optimization. There's better Python scripting. All the tables and tools are easier to pin. There's better annotation and just some minor. You don't need to be admin to add everything anymore. So again, the PDS ISIS 2, ISIS 3 supports attached, detached, tiled, raw, doesn't matter. Map projections, almost all of them. So I always kick Randy for supporting some unique projections in ISIS. So the one projection that we don't support well in ARC is called oblique cylindrical with a rotation. And that you can't use that. And so what's released in that? Cassini. Cassini is released in that projection, doesn't work in ArcMap. You're gonna have to reproject it before you use some Cassini data. Doesn't matter, 16, 32-bit. If ISIS supported 64-bit, it would work. Multiple bands. The new thing about ArcMap is, before you bring any high data, 32-bit, 16-bit data into ArcMap, you wanna build statistics. So you basically right-click on the image and you say, make me statistics. We'll talk about editing later. And so let's actually just jump into this. I guess I should talk about map projections. I'll just show this figure. Map projections, you're trying to fit something on a sphere to a flat surface. No matter what you do, that's gonna cause distortion in the map projection, whether it's area, length, or angle. So there's no projection that supports equal length across the whole map. There's projections that support equal area, like sinusoidal. So just be cognizant of that. The reason why Mercator is used for Google Earth is because it supports angles well. So when you're driving, you can say, I'm gonna go north, and north is north. For mapping, again, Mercator's not very good above 45. And Mercator does not exist at the pole, so can't use it for polar. But essentially, every map projection has different distortions. Most of the tools that we have to add on to ArcMap take that away. You don't have to worry about it. If you calculate area, it'll calculate area using geodesic measures, so it looks at it on a sphere or even a 3D body. So if you use the right tool, you'll get the right answer. These are the different kinds of map projections. Azimuthal, cylindrical, conic. So conic is good for the mid-latitudes, cylindrical good for the equator, and azimuthal polar, stereographic for polar too. Okay, so if everybody can start up ArcMap, the first exercise is we're gonna look at how to load a base from an online service. So if you look at ArcMap again, here's our table of contents. You can see I have an extra window turned on. I'm gonna turn that off. You can also see I have a bunch of windows docked over here, if you can see that. These are kind of flyouts. They fly in and out. If I wanna keep them locked, I can lock it. So I have a bunch of things like search. Here's the catalog, here's all my files. So, but the first thing we're gonna do is there's file, add data, but there's also this drop down here, add data. So go to add data and add data from ArcGIS Online. So why can we do this? We've already gone, before we started the conference, we started to gather all the different services that the community supports, and we put them onto a data repository called ArcGIS Online, and it's free. It's just a catalog, it's not really data, it's just a catalog. And so when I see this, I start seeing all this US stuff. But if I go here and type Mars, you'll notice you'll get some you'll get some weird tutorials in Portugal, but you'll get a bunch of stuff. And this isn't all from USGS, it's not all from ESA or from the HRSC team, it's just a mix. So this one happens to be, this one over here, this Mars MOLA elevation, happens to be from ESRI. They did a story on the rovers, and so they loaded a Mars base map. We have several different kind of test WMSs. If you look for, we'll try to put the name in here, called Astrogeology. I believe there should, here's Planet Server from Angelo, Jacob University. We have ArcGIS Server, that's from me also. You can see that services by USGS down at the bottom. Here's a server from the HRSC team. And so when you click on this, you'll get more information. I'm gonna click on the title, or I guess you click on details. And it has a little abstract. Now what we need to work on is better abstracts, better credits, better information and metadata for these services. Right now it's pretty sparse. So the first one I actually want you to load is go back to the top, and there's this thing called ArcGIS Server Mars MDM21. The reason why I want to use this one is because this is ESRI, this knows it's Mars. So when I use ArcGIS Server for ArcGIS, it can talk planetary together. When I use a WMS and ArcMap, it will not know it's Mars. And that's what we're still working on that. So why can I use this? I'll explain it in a little bit. But I can use WMSs that think they are Earth for planetary data. And so just trust me on that for now, and we'll explain it in a second. So find this color MDM, see if we can crash my server. So this is actually running from Flagstaff. So this file is, I believe it's 6 gigabytes. And so how did it come up so fast? Well, it's obviously we're playing tricks on you. We're only loading. This is a tiled. It's split up into lots of pieces. It's the same way that Google and JMARS does this. It's split up into tiny little JPEGs, and there's different versions of it. And so as I zoom in, it's going to take a while, and you can see that this globe is spinning down here. But I will actually, this has the full fidelity of the Viking image. This is full resolution. And there's not really any limits to this. We have the Japanese Kaguya TC, the train camera mosaic. That's a 500 gig mosaic, and it's served online, and it's fast. So you can play these tricks. If I made everybody download 500 gigs just to see a certain area, we're trying to get away from that. Oh, so can nobody do this? You have to be online. Did anybody get a Torq? You got a Torq? You should need to, so you don't need an account to use this, so I'm not sure. No, it should be okay. That's good, but keep that one. We can skip it. This is just to show you that there are online resources. I'm gonna go ahead and add, so now I'm gonna pull this trick of, you know, we've heard yesterday about all these WMSs. This is how WMSs integrate into our applications. Yes? So this is not a WMS. This is a tiled server from ArcGIS, and so they talk together. But the WMS query, the reason why we use these online services is so that you don't have to know that. But I'll show you how to get to it. So again, this is not a WMS. This is a ESRI tiled map server. So can I use this as a WMS? I can, because this server also supports WMS. So I'm gonna do one more. I'm gonna do another add data from ArcGIS Online. Now I think we're killing the network. So I'm actually going to type Mars WMS. So you also notice here's the Mars WMS for JMARS. They support a few layers as a WMS. But what I want you to load is, I want you to load this one, WMS Mars Server Astrogeology. And I'm going to look at its details, and you can see that, again, the abstract is horrible. Need to fix that. So again, is everybody looking at this one? Just go ahead and click Add Data. So one thing that the TOC allows is you can order. So this means that I'm running this one on top, this is next, and so order's important. So the first thing it does is, for some reason, ArcMap does this all the time. When you load a WMS, it turned on every single layer in the WMS. With WMS, again, web mapping server, that's the worst thing it could do, because now it just asks the server to return 10 layers as one image, as one flattened. So the first thing you need to do is turn off all these layers. You'll also notice that one thing they've tried to do as a trying to be a nice data host is that when you load a WMS, there's actually a little tiny box down here. And that box is where you can find out, hopefully, again, as we fill out better metadata, this is where you find out who made this. This is where you give credit to that base. And so right now there's a list of like everybody in the community, just because NASA, JPL, ESA, but just so you know that you can, when you're using a WMS, you can give credit, try to give proper credit. You can give references, whatever you want. So I have my list of layers I'm going to turn on. Let's turn on Themis IR Day. So this is also coming from Flagstaff. It's actually coming from Phoenix, Arizona. You can see it's much slower. This is not a tiled service, so it's not as fast. I think everybody's asking for it now, so it takes a while. It is optimized, but it's not as fast as a tiled server. So you have to be more patient with this WMS, at least. It should come back, but let me go ahead and zoom in, try to make it speed up. And you can see that when it's running, it's actually going to tell you down here that it's, I'm still working. Give me a second. And we could be overloading the server too. So one of the things that the OGC, the WMS community has been doing is trying to make sure that we optimize all these services. You can see how slow this one is. So it's usually not this slow. So I'm just going to pretend that worked. So one thing, just so everybody understands, the reason why I loaded this one first, I said that this one knows it's Mars. So why is that important? When I go look, this data frame can have one projection. The images can be multiple projections. This view can have one projection. And if I go look at its projection, if I double-click on layers or right-click properties, just double-click on layers, you'll see that under coordinate system, it says what it's currently set to. It's set to Mars 2000 sphere. Now, how did it know that? Because the first layer it brought in was Mars 2000 sphere. So if you're worried about setting your map projection, bring in a good layer first. If the layer is properly defined, then everything else will try to follow that layer. If you don't know it's properly defined, double click on layers and you'll see what it's referenced as. You'll see that it's, oh, you know, somebody defined this as Venus, it's wrong. So what is, why is that important? Now everything else I add to this data frame will be forced into Mars, which is a good thing. Even a WMS that thinks it's Earth, a WMS that thinks it's Earth will now be Mars. And so that's how we can trick WMS to use planetary. It's not sexy, it's not good, but it's one method. So let's go back. Any questions about that? I know we're faking the system, but again, the reason why that works is because most WMSs are in decimal degrees. If you tell it that it's Mars, it will make sure that it changes radius. It'll actually change from an Earth radius to a Mars radius, and everything will line up. Measurements will be okay. So we're still working on that to make sure that WMSs can be Mars.
Trent, sorry, there's a question here.
Thank you. You mean that when I load the second layer, if the coordinate system is different, ArcGIS reproject in real time?
Yes, from any projection.
Okay.
If it understands that projection.
Okay. So I have to see the WMS Mars server in my view overload on the ArcGIS server image. That's right.
Yeah, and what I mean by that is if I'm working with HiRISE and I bring in a HiRISE image and it says HiRISE is Mars, when I bring in a WMS layer, it will make that WMS layer into the same projection as the HiRISE image.
Okay.
And that's something new with QGIS too.
Okay. But they are not superposed in my view, so I don't know why, but maybe...
For your WMS?
Yes, WMS is it's not appearing with ArcGIS server image. So I try to zoom, I will try harder. Sorry.
So this one did work. I'll have to look at that, but it should just work. But obviously that doesn't always happen. So if we look at that, I'm actually going to turn on a nice little effects toolbar. Let's see. So I'm gonna blink. This is an effects toolbar that allows you to blink and swipe between layers. So this Themis mosaic, even though it's defined as Mars, the WMS tells it that it's Earth. And so, but because we loaded in that first image that says it's Mars, it's gonna force the WMS to be Mars. So I think we can just, if it doesn't work the first time, you know, we can try it again. But we can see the registration is pretty good. And if I even load the same image, and I need to turn off blinking. So you can see again that using data from a server is a little slow. So I'm going to blink between the same two images. And you can see a little bit of a contrast stretch. One's a little more stretchy than the other. But registration is pretty much spot on. So even though the WMS, again, the WMS thinks it's Earth, but we should be okay. So that's why, even though I desperately want to fix WMSs, it works. They still work. Okay, so pretend that everything's working. And we're going to go quickly to the next exercise. Um So a lot of times the first data people want to load is table data. You have a list of lat longs. If it's polygons, it's going to be a little harder. But if it's just a list of center points, then the easiest way to do it is a table, a comma-separated table. So like CSV, it could be an Excel file. The only trick is that you need a header line. And what do I mean by that? I'm going to look at the exercises for exercise one. Here's my CSV. So here's the only trick. The only trick is I have a line that says what that field is. Name, latitude, longitude. You'll notice I like to put in 180 east so that I know I'm using 180 east. Because I might have multiple tables that say 360 west or something. So name, comma, lat, comma, lon. Keep it simple. And then I have my values. So I'm going to go back to here, and I'm going to say add data. So I'm not going to do anything but say add data. And you guys should see, I think you see the exercise data under documents. Can you guys find this data? Sometimes it's hard to find. I should be loading that, the VM, so I'm using the same system you are. So by default, when I add data, if you can find this MSL file, can everybody find that? If you can't, let me know. But you'll notice it says, hey, I kind of recognize this file. It's a CSV, I sort of recognize this. It also says I can recognize an Excel spreadsheet. Hit or miss whether it actually works for Excel. So all I'm going to do is click on the CSV and click Add. Now it didn't show anything. We haven't told it what's longitude and what's latitude yet. So it loaded it as a table. And this is something good to check. If I right-click on it, I'll say Open, and here's that same table, latitude, longitude. And so just like as the instruction says, we're going to right-click on that table and display XY. So display XY data. So again, right-click on the table, display XY. And this is the opportunity it says. X, it tries to figure out that X is lon. It tries to figure out that Y is lat. It did it correctly. I currently don't have a Z. I don't have a height, but I could. And how the hell did it know it Mars? It doesn't. The table doesn't say it's Mars. But because I loaded that first layer as Mars, now it will say try to default to Mars. So that's another reason for loading this base image, is just because it helps you set up your environment as Mars. So if it doesn't say it's Mars, I have to go in there and specify that it's Mars. And that you go through this edit function. I'm not going to do that right now. But again, setting up this first layer always helps everything be a little bit smoother. Make these big. Oops. Okay. So what am I showing? I'm showing the landing sites. Obviously, we picked Gale, but this was the optional landing sites previously for MSL. So that's hard to see. All I did was, if I right-click on that layer, if you guys actually got it to draw, there's a bunch of options under right-click for ArcMap. You right-click everything. And if you right-click and you say Label Features, it'll actually understand that it needs to label. And it tries to pick the string that's in the table. If you notice, I clicked on the symbol, and I can change the symbol. OK, so what I wanted to get across here is that loading tables are easy if it's nicely formatted and it's simply formatted. You need to specify what planet it's on when you load it. And so by loading that first layer, it helps you specify that it's Mars. So just try to keep it the workflow a little simple. So the next thing is we're gonna jump through this pretty quick, but all these are online and there's a lot more tutorials like this. We're gonna add in an existing GIS file called a shapefile. And so we happen to have nomenclature. So on our nomenclature, or the IAU supported and NASA supported nomenclature site, we have GIS files for all the planets. And they have a lot of information underneath each point. But let's go in there. So we're gonna do, again, add data. We're gonna find, if you can find your exercise directory, there's a folder called exercise 2. So I'll go back to my add data. I can go up a level, and I'm gonna go into exercise 2 nomenclature. And you'll notice I have Mars and Moon. So I'll go into Mars. So what is a shapefile? A shapefile is simply either points, lines, or polygons. It's not both. You can only have points, you can only have lines or polygons. They can't be a mixture like KML. So why did this layer work? It's not because of anything I set. It's because this layer, I'm going to look at its properties. So if I, again, double-click on anything or right-click properties, I'll bring up the information for that layer. If you look at its source tab, so again, I'm on underneath the nomenclature layer. I look at its source tab, and I can tell that it is predefined as Mars 2000. So that means that if I load this file first, it's going to set my data frame to Mars. So that's another way to set Mars, is find a file that's good, load it first, and then everything else will follow. And so what can we do? I'm not going to have you follow me. But what can we do with nomenclature? We can tell it to symbolize based on, how about the type? And so now we've categorized them by feature type, craters, fluctus fossae. And just so you know you can do this, I don't want you to have to, if I only want to show craters that are named, I can set a query on that, just like a kind of a SQL. I can set a query on that layer. And don't worry about following me, but I can say, I want to only show types equal to craters. So it helps me build this query for me, but my query is type equals crater craters. I hit OK, and everything else is hidden. So now we only have craters shown. Let's do one more. We'll do just clear that. How about we'll do diameter? Diameter greater than 150 kilometers. So everything else is hidden. Now we have all the features above 150 kilometers. So this just kind of proves the point of that we're looking at features, and features have information behind them that we can use. Okay, and then I wanted to show, you can do this in QGIS too. So I just stated that this information, that these features, go ahead. Yes. So and here's something that we don't do a lot. This will be interesting to see if this works. So I'm going to remove my query. So under symbology, there's a lot of ways to change this, and you can spend hours just playing with this. There's ways to do unique values. You can do quantities. So quantities, I'm going to show, this is a numeric. So I can show the size based on a color range. And I can say that I want it to be 12. And here's the cool part, is that I can also, now I can go into advanced and say symbol level. Let's see, that's not what I want. It's graduated symbols. So now I'm showing different symbol sizes based on there. And so that's a kind of a good way to do kind of a heat map. Now the bigger circles are bigger. And you can actually specify how big that is in meters. So you can kind of get a sense. You can actually put in that this crater circle needs to be this in meters based on the attribute of in diameter. It gets a little tricky because we're in a weird projection here. And not only can I do that, I can also, now I can change these to be red. So now my largest ones are red. So under symbology, there's thousands of ways to deal with this kind of, let's see if it's here now. If we had rotation, if you wanted to show something that was rotated, you can set a rotating parameter based on a field. So it's everything's 45 degrees or it's defined by the attribute. You can actually do, let's try this. So this is a little too messy, but you can actually, every symbol, you can have multiple things shown as a chart. So I'm just showing min, max, lat, long diameter, but you can have it shown as a chart or a bar. So you can kind of get crazy with the symbology here. But we just want to show data. We don't want to go crazy yet. So the next thing, we're just going to jump right into this, and sorry if you're lost already. I know these are short. We're doing really short hands-on. So now we just talked about loading shapefiles. So one of the things that the Mars ODE supplies is MOLA and LOLA shapefiles. And this is it's great because trying to download the whole catalog is extremely annoying. And so if you go to the Mars ODE, the Lunar ODE, you can actually say, I want to grab this shapefile, this MOLA as a shapefile. And so let's go back to ArcMap, and we're going to go add data. And so I've gone to the ODE, I've asked for a shapefile, you just ask for a box, and you download a zip file. And that zip file contains this GIS layer. I'm going to add data, go to exercise 3. And you'll notice that this shapefile contains this designator, and this is optional, but it contains this designator called Z. And what that generally means is that that this shapefile has x and y, so it has latitude, longitude, but also as part of that point file, it has a z, as a z elevation. So the z is in the table, but it's also actually part of the geometry. So x, y, z in the geometry. Now, does that help? I'm going to add the shapefile. And you can see it's just for Gale Crater. So that's not very useful. So what do we need to do now? We need to change the colors. We need to change the ramp. So the way to change, do I actually say it? No. Is I do the same thing. I go into the layer properties. We talked about single symbols. So right now it's a single symbol and it's pink. I'm going to go to quantities, graduated colors, and I'm going to pick topography. So now we can see that it's colorized. So one of the problems is these dots have these black rims. So how do we get rid of the black rims? We can do one at a time. You can click on the symbol, and you can get rid of the black rim. I'm going to click up here on symbol, properties for all symbols. So again, click on the top, properties for all symbols. So, properties for all symbols, edit symbol, and turn off use outline. So, double click, go to gradational, properties for all symbols, turn off use outline. So, one of the things, if you guys haven't heard, ArcMap, this version of ArcMap doesn't exist in probably 3 years. They have a new version that just came out, and all the dialogues are different. Every user interface button is different. It acts the same, it's the same engine, but once you get used to this, it's going to change on you. So just be warned. But they made it simpler, so hopefully. So you'll notice when I do that, a little quirk is all the symbols go away. I think they all turned white. So I tell it to not turn off outline. Now I'm going to pick another ramp, and you'll see it comes back. So this symbol tab is an annoying, kind of hard to use, but once you get used to it, you'll be really quick at it. So just play around with it. Choose different fields. Instead of topography, let's do longitude. We should all know what that looks like. So now we just have a nice color ramp across. It's kind of looking. Yes. Oh. How do you change it? Oh. Yes. So if you click on here again, flip symbols. Yep. There's multiple ways to do that, unfortunately. When you're working with images, there's actually a checkbox called invert. But under symbols, it's flip. You'll notice that I have a ramp that you don't have. I have kind of the more typical rainbow. You can make your own ramps, and you can save them. I don't really want to get into that, but you can, if I go to properties, there's this kind of weird color editor that's kind of clumsy, but it works. So I'm going to go back to topography. So that's not horrible. It's not horrible, but that's not very useful for doing 3D. So I think one of the things I wanted to go into this was not necessarily for you to follow me, but just to show you where these tools are. So we've loaded a Mars base. It could be a download from Mercator, it could be a download from HRSC. We've loaded nomenclature. That's nice to show the names. We've loaded MOLA data, or any kind of craters, dunes. But now we actually want to run ArcMap. We want to do something in ArcMap. So the first place I go to find tools, and this is why you can't learn ArcMap in an hour. You just have to play and play and play for days. There's this thing called search. So if I open up, there's this button over here called search, Control F. Search, you can search for maps and data, tools, images. It'll catalog your hard drive. But I want to make a surface. So I'm going to type surface and see what I get. So by default, it's going to return all the tools that ArcMap has. If you want to actually see a list of these tools, we'll go look at this. But this is so hard to find tools in here. There's so many. If you look under 3D analyst, 3D features, there's buffer and difference and inside. So I don't use this. I use search. And hopefully, if you get used to this interface, it's not horrible. But I'll go back to my search button, search for surface. And you'll notice that here's curvature and here's hill shades and here's contours. I actually know what I want for this example. I'm going to do an interpolation called natural neighbor. So most people, the MOLA team uses a, this is just side note, MOLA team uses a spline tension using GMT. That's fine. It's a very soft interpolation. It means that craters will have hollows. Craters have dips in their rims. You'll see that in between the tracks, it's very soft. And actually, the actual interpolated point, the point, pixels that contain a point will actually change. So every resolution of MOLA has different elevation values at the same point. And that's because a spline interpolation allows it to change that original value. And natural neighbor probably does too, but natural neighbor is, there's actually, I think, two or three publications on why this is better for MOLA. And it's better because it looks at, it tries to maintain rims, but it also highlights errors. So you gain one thing, you lose another. So I'm going to click on natural neighborhood. And when I click on that, it brings up a tool, how to run the tool. So under each, every single one of these tools is a GUI. So currently I'm going to run, I did a search, do it one more time. I did a search for natural neighbor. Click on that tool, and now it asks me to fill out, runs me through a little wizard. Load my petters or my MOLA shots. What's my Z field? I don't want it to be latitude, I want it to be topography.
Will I get an error back saying that there is no spatial analyst license currently available when I try to...
Okay, so that's in the VM? Okay, so when you have that problem, ArcMap has different versions, has licenses. I just heard that the version that you guys are running hasn't turned on 3D Analyst. So you need to go to customize. This is in the VM, you need to go to customize extensions. So this allows you to turn on more expensive parts of ArcMap. If you don't own 3D Analyst, you can't run this tool. So, they try to gouge you at any time they can for more money. So you'll want to turn on 3D Analyst. You might as well turn on Spatial Analyst. So these are all extra. These cost more money, of course. I actually am a huge fan of Geostatistical Analyst. It is, do you not see that? Let me see. Just the last one? Go ahead and activate it. Yeah, just go ahead and turn it on. Oh, the first one is fine. Let's turn on 3D Analyst and Spatial Analyst. So the reason why they want you to turn these on and off is because you can share these across your colleagues. So you could have four versions of ArcMap and one version of 3D Analyst, and you can share 3D Analyst. But that means you have to turn it off when you're not using it. This is a trial version, and it has all the extensions. I think for students can get this for free for a year. Universities usually have ArcMap available. NASA centers can get ArcMap for free. USGS, we get it for free, just because we pay a license. If you want to play around, if you want to learn ArcMap and you don't want to pay, you can get it for $100. You're not supposed to do work, but you can get it for $100 for a year if you just want to try it. But again, if you buy it, if you use this trial version, you get it for 6 months. If you buy one of their books, you probably get a 6-month license. You can figure out how to kind of get this to work. But that's one reason why we decided to show QGIS too, as a light introduction to a free GIS. The reason why, again, we use ArcMap is because it actually is powerful. It has a lot of tools, has a lot of built-in functionality that QGIS is gaining, but it doesn't have yet. So we're going to turn on those extensions. I'm going to open my search window, find my natural neighbor again. And so I'm going to fill this out. So one thing that I haven't done, and I probably should have done already. So running my tool Natural Neighborhood, I'm filling it out with my MOLA shots. It says it's Z, so how come it didn't know to use Z? Well, it's letting me specify it based on the table. So I could actually do a surface based on any parameter. It could be depth, or it could be any parameter in there. So why is this kind of a crazy low value? It's because our map projection is in degrees. And so one of the first things I should have done is set a proper projection for this area. And I'm not going to go into that now, but ideally in this region, you know, this might be good, and this actually might be good in simple cylindrical. It would be good in Mercator, sinusoidal, but I'm just going to go ahead and let it default. So this output cell size is in degrees, so it's kind of weird. I'm just going to hit play and see what happens. So as it's running, you'll see this status bar down here. And so now we have a nice surface. Okay, we're gonna do, we'll do, is it really that late? 11. Okay, so now we're gonna play around with a little more advanced. Just so you guys know this exists. But so interpolation of surfaces, it could be any parameter, Z or otherwise. I'm gonna, if you right click on your interface, I mentioned that it has tons and tons of toolbars. I right clicked on an empty area. So right click on an empty area, you'll see all the different toolbars. I'm gonna turn on 3D Analyst. So 3D Analyst is shown here, and it has a layer. The layer, you might not have this if you weren't able to interpolate a surface, but the layer is the DEM. You'll notice that it has a kind of a bad name right now, but it's just natural neighborhood shape. And then there's some things we can do here. We can do a single contour. We can do show me downslope. Show me a line that goes downslope, and that's mostly for hydro, rivers. Drop a point down in 3D, or drop a line down in 3D. So again, just so you know this exists, you don't have to follow. I'm going to click on interpolate a line across my DEM. My DEM is selected. I'm going to interpolate a line. And now, okay, what did that do? For every pixel, it actually added a Z to this line. And what does that let me do now? I can now profile that line that has Z's across it. So I'm going to profile. And again, why are we in weird numbers here? Because we're in degrees. So ideally, we should have set a projection in meters, and then that would show in meters. So we've just dropped a line. We've got a nice Gale crater central peak. And here's something that I use quite a bit. Say I want to do a difference of the rim. I'm actually going to drop a second line down. And you'll notice that these are just graphics. They're not actually inside of a feature file. They're not a shape file. They're just drawn on my screen. But I can actually click on this, and I can click on the properties of that graphic and change its color. So I'm going to change it to red. So again, I can select this line, and I can profile it. That's nice. But what if I select both of them? So you can do this with as many lines as you want. You'll also notice that this is they're actually changing the charting method. This charting methods are all done, I think, through Microsoft Charts, which is, as we all know, Excel can be confusing, but it's the same. So I'm actually going to click inside of this chart and look at its properties. So once I've drawn a profile, I can look at its properties. And so I can change the label, the title. I can see that there's two graphs here. And what I really want to point out is that I can export. So again, inside of the chart, I can export. And here it's like, okay, I can export a bitmap SVG, but I can also export the data. And so if I export that to Excel, now I can actually plot it in whatever I'm used to plotting. So you're not stuck with ArcMap for plotting. You can export profiles, export tables, or you can actually export it as a HTML if you really want to. So just so you know that there's a lot of options for getting the data out. We said yesterday, I said sometimes it's not always good to force into GIS. Why don't we pull some data outside? So this is some ways to get data out. I don't think I want to show this next exercise. But let's look at colorizing the DEM. Yes. It should be, I'm pretty sure by default it's using, it'll drop a Z at every pixel. And it actually, if you're too dense, it probably segregates the line into 100 vertices, something like 100 vertices, and puts it and then drops a Z at every 100th vertice. So yeah, it's almost always dense enough to realize the profile though. So you're right. When you're using this tool, you don't have control over that. Other tools, you do have control over how many Z's you put into that. So that's a good point.
Before I was able to click on them and remove them.
Okay. So like we looked at symbols. You'll notice that this interpolated surface is classified by elevation, and it doesn't make necessarily for a good color ramp. So if we look at raster symbology, just as there is for vector symbology, there's hundreds of options. So, you know, we can, this is actually fairly new, but we can actually show vector fields now. And this is something new. This was horrible in earlier versions. But this functionality allows you to show wind directions or magnitudes. And so this is actually a nice way to represent topography now. Not topography, I'm sorry, but, you know, wind magnitudes. I'm actually symbolizing by, I have no idea. And this appears to be new with 10.3. So one thing I actually calculated a table for the DEM, and I don't know why I did that, but so doing unique fields for rasters is probably not a good idea. It originally came up as, it's called classified, so they have bins. What I normally do and what you'll normally see images come in as is stretched. Stretched means from min to max based on a stretch. Now, standard deviation is still a linear stretch, but it's using 2.5, it starts at 2.5 standard deviations in, and I can specify, how about 2 standard deviation? But again, that's just to define the min-max and then does a linear stretch across that color ramp. Histogram equalization is a little different. If I hit OK, you can see that now we have a stretched color ramp, and I can specify a color table. And here's my nice rainbow, which everybody uses and I always discourage. Because rainbows are not good for colorblind. So if we just do between 3. So there's lots of options here. And if you notice, if you look at an image's property, if it's not a served layer, if it's a local layer, you can look at, you can set background values, and you can do no data colorization. I can apply a gamma stretch, so I can, if your image is too dark, you can set a slight stretch in the gamma. But you also have a bunch of options underneath here. So just think about ArcMap as you're gonna have to uncover lots of different hidden things. And so double click on layers, double click on all the options, see what else there is available. If I look at right now, I can say, how am I resampling to the screen? So I'm going to do a cubic convolution to the screen. That's all that means. So as I zoom in, no matter how pixelated it is, it'll look very smooth. Now let me set this resample to nearest neighbor, and now you can actually see the pixels. So you can make your data look better, but it's false. So here's bilinear, and again, this is just for, it doesn't do anything for the calculations, it's just doing it to the screen. But I can also set here, I can set transparencies. And at any time, and this is, again, how do we get out of ArcMap, or how do we get out of a GIS? At any time, I can right-click on any layer, almost any layer, and I can say data export. So this next exercise was how do I save out a colorized image? Again, right-click. I can zoom to raster resolution to see my fidelity. But again, right-click, there's all these options. and I can export data. So by default, it's going to export a DM, a 32-bit floating point file. But if I want to export color to JPEG, I can use render and force RGB. So that's going to use the renderer, the colorized renderer that I currently have selected, and it's going to force an RGB color ramp. And you can notice it also switched it to 8-bit. Now, one of the first things, I can also reproject in here. It's a little dangerous, but I can actually say I brought this in and it's in sinusoidal, but I want it to output to Mercator. During this export step, I can specify that I want to use a different projection, and I can specify the cell size. So again, we have this weird degrees per pixel cell size. And you'll also notice it has this weird no data. So the reason why it has this no data is because the original data was 32-bit. So if I don't want it, if my colors are RGB, I don't want any no data value, then you just remove it. Or you can set it to zero. If I remove it, it's not going to set a no data value. So no data value is special. It doesn't, if it's defined as no data, it's not used in calculations. It's not displayed unless you tell it to. So when you have data, color data, and it's not coming in as no data, we need to specify that. And that you can do in its properties. You can actually go into an image property and say -9 is no data. I can specify which format. So here I can go straight to JPEG 2000, GeoTIFF. I recommend TIFF just because it maintains it across multiple applications. These TIFFs are very compatible with QGIS, Map Server, lots of applications, Envy. So I'm going to call this color. And you can set a compression if you want to. I usually pick LZW, but it doesn't matter. So where is it going? It's going to my some funky drive that I don't have right now. Probably the worst thing about ArcMap is when you're doing this analysis, you end up with files everywhere, all over the place. So just try to keep it clean. Try to keep one master directory. And as you're exporting data, as you're importing data, copy all your data to a single directory, or you'll end up with a mess of files. For me, yes?
It doesn't allow me to change the format when I save it.
Let's see. Let me start this saving. Oh. So you'll notice, so this is grayed out?
Yes.
I don't know.
It says, file geodata.
Oh. Okay, so you're doing a you're trying to save out a shapefile.
Yeah.
So you need to change it to, instead of file geodatabase, change it to a shapefile. So we haven't talked about, I alluded to that we support these things called file geodatabases. They're actually kind of a database to organize your data. It's a flat file database, and it's something that we highly recommend. But they get to be a little confusing. It's like a proper database. And so if you're trying to export data and it says, hey, you're trying to export a geodatabase file, you have to be exporting into a geodatabase. So you have to have a geodatabase available to export into. If you don't, then look at the options to see what else you can export as. Export a shapefile, which is standalone. You can export a table. Just look at, again, play around in the GUI and look at the options for exporting. But if something is blocked, it's trying to protect you from doing the wrong thing, but it's frustrating because I didn't do anything wrong. But just look at the options underneath that dialog. So exporting an image, you'll notice the location actually wants a directory, and this is one of the worst designs, is that it makes you pick a directory. And so if you're fighting trying to get this to export, just try to pick a directory and hit OK. So the next annoying thing that ArcMap does is it loves to apply a color ramp, and it loves to apply a stretch on your images. So here's my original stretch. I'm actually going to remove these graphics. Let me turn off the background. So I'm going to use my select, drag a box, and just hit delete. I can turn off my MSL events. This was my original RGB. I loaded it, I exported it, and it turns out and it looks like this. So the first thing ArcMap does, if I double click on that exported layer, I'm going to look at symbology, and it goes, you know what, I think your data needs a stretch. And I'm going to do a percent clip, and I'm going to give you a gamma. And I didn't ask for it, but it did it because it tries to optimize your image. You can turn this off. You can say, never apply a stretch to my images if it drives you nuts. It's easy enough to just go into here and say none, and you get back the original. Now, why do I have a black line here? That's because I turned off zero as no data. So if I hit zero, then this would have gone away. So I probably should have put zero in there. I thought we were square, but there is a no data bar here. So that's what that black line is. So when I exported it, I should have set no data as zero. Then that the pixels would still be there, but they'd be turned off. So just like any other option, I'll go to symbology, and here's a display 000 as nothing. And that's a way to get rid of that. That's how to get rid of colors too. Around images if you have black colors. Okay. So we're going to run out of time quick. So I just want to show you a couple advanced functions that a lot of people don't use yet. And I find them really powerful. It's one of the aspects, I think all the applications are going to go this way, but this is actually very, very capable already. And I call it virtual image processing or delayed processing. And it's going to be a simple example. So I'm going to take this color image, and we're going to apply a virtual function to it. Before I do that, I'm actually going to run a hillshade on my DEM. So I go back to my handy search. So go to my search button, and I'm going to type hillshade. And you can see that, why are there two? One is licensed by 3D analyst, and one is licensed by spatial analyst. So they have overlap. But I'm going to click on hillshade. I believe this is in the notes. I can drag and drop files from anywhere, usually. So we've been talking about that I haven't been using a projection. I'm using Mars, which is, again, kind of a bad way to work. We want to be in a map projection in meters. So it came up with this warning, and it goes, I can see that your X and Y coordinate system is different than your Z coordinate system. My X and Y is degrees. My Z is in meters. So it's like, I think you have a problem here. And it's not really a problem. It's just saying that I recognize that your coordinate systems are different. Hillshades like to be X, Y, Z all in meters if you're going to do hillshades, because it needs to know exaggeration. It needs to know, it likes to have all the units in the same. So it says, you know, hey, there's a problem here. And here's a conversion for feet. Hey, do you have a feet? Are you mixing feet and meters? It's like, no, I'm mixing degrees and meters. So I just happen to know that this will probably work. I'm going to do an exaggeration of 0.0001, just as a guess. I need to get my Z into the same system as my XY. I need to get my Z into more compatible degrees. And it sounds crazy, but Again, if we were working in a projection, this would go away. But here's our azimuth and attitude. So we've got a 350, 315, and we're going to have the sun at a 45 degree angle. Hit OK. So if I would have, I'm going to run this again. So here's my hillshade. You'll notice it's a little harsh. Why? Because it set a stretch for me again. That's OK. I'm going to run this again. And I'm going to let it default to 1. And it gives me this warning again. So whenever you see your hillshade come back like this, that means that there's something wrong. They're not in the same, X, Y, and Z are not in the same units. So just be wary of that. The way around it is you can set a very small exaggeration. And that's kind of the take-home point for ArcMap is there's a lot of quirks like that, that you kind of have to understand what system you're in, the data you're working with. So I think the last thing we'll demo before, is it coffee break? Coffee break is this thing called Image Analyst. So it's a new window. It's been around for a few versions, but it's actually starting to work really well. You can see that it wants to work with images, so it only has images highlighted. The first thing I can do is I'll pick my DEM, and right away it gives me options to do contrast and gamma and transparency, just like from the other interface. I can set my stretch, I can set the interpolation, I can blink, but then there's this little thing down here called processing. And something new in ARC 10, you'll notice way down here, is this thing called mensuration. I'll just explain what this is. So ArcMap now supports camera models. The reason why ISIS exists is to support camera models. It allows you to map from camera to ground, image to ground. So ArcMap now supports camera models, so if we were to write an HRSC camera model, we could actually work with raw data in ArcMap. Now I would never do that, just because it's too much, I think. But maybe in the future, we might be able to use raw data in ArcMap. Orthorectify on the fly, and the key is you need to be able to calibrate it, and you need to have the camera model. But camera model, you can add your own custom camera models into ArcMap. So, you know, if all the sensor models get put into QGIS or AWSM or ArcMap, then programs like ISIS may not be as needed for simple mapping. Obviously, ISIS does other things besides just camera models. But mensuration tools allows you to do shape. You can do, if you have the camera model again and you have the topography, you can do shadow heights. So if you measure a shadow, it'll tell you the height of that feature. Again, that requires that camera model. So it supports a lot of Earth sensors currently, but for planetary, we don't have any. To get back to this processing, I'm going to take, in this image analyst window, I'm going to take my DEM, I'm going to set a color map, and I'm going to tell it to hillshade. So shaded relief. So what is this? This new image. You can see it was really quick. This image doesn't exist. It's a virtual image. And that image has functions. And the first function it's applying is called shaded relief. So if I double click on that function, I can manipulate its parameters. I can change the color ramp. I can change the output type. I can change the ramp again here. But you can see it's doing, I changed the scaling to help me with the scaling. So it's doing a colorized hillshade on the fly. It doesn't exist, it's only in memory. As I zoom in, it recalculates it. So if it's huge, if it's a 50 gig DEM, it'll show it to you at resolution. As I zoom in, it gets better and better. Now that I've made this shaded relief, and I want to burn it, I want to export it, I export it, and it'll actually calculate a shaded relief for me at each pixel accurately. So what else can I do with this? Again, it's a series of, it's a virtual file. I can go in here and say, I'm going to insert a function. Let's see, let's do a, you can see all these different functions. I'm going to do a local function. Oh, I don't really want a local function, do I? Sorry. I just want to do a simple filter. Convolution, here we go. So I'm going to do a Laplacian 3x3, or how about just a simple smoothing? I'm actually going to insert it before the shading. So I'm actually going to smooth my DEM before shading. So image, smoothing filter, shaded relief filter. On the fly, just recreated it for me. I can export an RGB TIFF. And so what else can I do? I can do band 1 divided by band 2. I can do, you can separate bands and do separate pieces and then do band math. If I wanted to, let me do one more example. I'm going to insert function. Minus, say my elevations are off by 2,000, so I need to add an offset. I'm going to actually do an add of minus 2,000. So now I'm doing a filter, I'm subtracting 2,000, then I'm doing a shaded relief. Why? I don't know, because that's what my data needs. Didn't change it because I'm just subtracting minus 2,000. And this comes with the free version of the standard version of ArcMap. It doesn't require any extra. The other cool things about this is if I have two layers, I can select both layers and I can do an instant difference map. Oh, not there. Difference. So now I've just created a virtual difference file of some two files I picked, I don't know. So this doesn't exist yet again. It's just a function. And I can change that function to be this minus this. I can, and it doesn't matter if they're different projections. It doesn't matter if they're different cell sizes. It will try to do the right thing, but it's actually pretty powerful. And the reason why I wanted to show you that is to show you the, at the base level ArcMap, kind of the power you get behind image manipulation. It's pretty powerful. The last thing, and I'll show before break, is this is what I wanted to show you. So a lot of times in Earth, we'll take hyperspectral data, and this can show 100 band data. You can mix R, G, and B. And then you want to pan sharpen it. You want to upsample the hyperspectral data so that it looks better. And I'm going to fake it out here. But I'm going to take my shaded relief. Actually, I'm going to go back to my color, open my window again. I'm going to pick my hill shade and my color. And here's this function called pan sharpen. So again, it upsamples multispectral data. It's a common algorithm for Earth. So by default, it looks horrible. And am I? So all I'm doing is I'm taking my color and I'm pan sharpening it with the gray hill shade. So why would I ever do that? I'm going to set it to a different style of pan sharpening. And I'm going to turn off, again, it brought it in stretched. So one of the problems I've always had with ArcMap is I'll set a transparency of 50, and I have this, and because I set a transparency, it turns my color ramp into these muted pastel things, and it's hard to tell on this screen. But by doing a pan sharpen, I can actually get a nice, more crispy, colorized thing. So you can play image tricks to get out better representations of your data too. So this is more like a multiply in Photoshop. But it could also be, I can take a colorized, say, Tess abundance, and I can pan sharpen it with a Mola Hillshade, and it'll make it look like it'll make a very attractive figure. You can export that as a TIFF, send it to your colleagues, and they can load it into their GIS. The reason why I wanted to highlight this is that the reason why we use GISs is to usually make figures. You want to make, you know, a nice figure, you want to make a nice poster, and so knowing that these tools exist is half the battle. And you know, something like this takes two command lines in GMT. But the thing that this is nice about is that I get to interact with it, I get to play with it, I get to do my profiles in an interactive mode. I remember when I said we can't use West. So because I kept on getting grief from everybody, we wrote this toolbar, and we can set West, and then you'll get back West longitudes over here. I forgot to mention this tool, but so you can at least display West, and you can display 0 to 360. If everybody's bugging you that you need, instead of minus 180 to 180, you can return. I don't think I've loaded this into your toolbar, but if you right click, if it is loaded, there's a thing called Display Latlon Toolbar. So I just wanted to highlight this, is that it's very easy to customize the interface. This is using a little Python, and it's interacting with the user. If I click using this, it's actually grabbing it into the Python window so I can copy and paste it. So there is a Python interpreter, and you can see that my values are getting copied down there. I can run code from here, just like QGIS. So I think we're going to take a coffee break. I know that was, I think we only got through about half. The most important part, the take-home part of this, is that I don't want to say data just works, but we're getting to the point where planetary data just works. If you download a DEM from HRSC, it'll load into ArcMap properly. If you download HRSC image, it will load appropriately. It doesn't matter if it's the same resolution. So the hard part is sometimes understanding if the data is GIS ready. So for CTX, nobody releases CTX in a GIS ready format. So there are some problems to getting data sets. Mola, GIS ready. Anything that comes off our site in ISIS format or GeoTIFF or GeoJPEG should be GIS ready. Look for the kind of the common denominators. If something doesn't work, someone's written a script to make it work. So my favorite example is from, I think it's Susan Conway from, I forget what university she's at.
Open.
Open, yeah, in London. It's ASU has very good data sets out there. They map projected CTX, and then they didn't add a GeoTIFF header to it. It's just a, it's a PNG, I think, or it's a JPEG 2000, and it has no GIS header. So Susan wrote a tool to take the header, an ISIS header, and the JPEG, and write out a geo header. So you can actually get CTX from ASU map projected. You just have to fix it. HiRISE actually still contains a label error in its GeoJPEG. It's GeoJPEG 2000. It contains a map projection error, so we wrote a program to fix it. So when something doesn't work, look on Google, email me. Almost always there's a fix if it doesn't come in right.
Or Slack.
Or Slack, yeah. And really, it's just, you're just going to have to play around. You have to play with the data. Why doesn't it work? Send me an email. There's usually a quick fix.
Okay.